did prove very successful because it was preventing free access to information, which was then impacting on reproductive rights. And that's a very good example for the Open Door Council case. I can't remember the full title, but it will be on our website, where the court then really provided an avenue where through information, because again, we've seen the reproductive rights definition under the Cairo Program of Action. Information is, it's vital. So the court played a very strong influential role in that case. And then, access to information was given. So, the courts are, very clearly a good avenue.
And the brothers, the educated brothers, killing their own sister, and the phenomenon is increasing. So just like dowry demands and the dowry dumping of baby girls in dustbins, which does not show in sex ratio, many of these fraternities which are mainly showing the gender violence at one level worse. I think it's very, very important what needs to be the legal, in terms of change of policy, because there is no such thing. Like, there was no hazardous drugs and cosmetics act for banning. There is no such thing as, this kind of thing. They don't come under anything. And even the monitoring and the documentation of that, and they misusing that the girl was abducted and raped. So someone is saying negotiating there about the sexual relationship. Here are marriage legally which is allowed above the age of 18. And incest definition, like in Andhra Pradesh, girls marry their own girls, and this is supposed to be okay. Culturally, in some communities, supposed to be done. Getting in Haryana, getting married to a girl in the same village is incest. And the question of gotras, your fathers, grandfathers, five generations like that, any of those words is considered wrong. Is considered considered a matter of it. So this is what we never thought. What is incest in certain communities and why is this kind of reaction? And the people who are doing that killing is the family members. And many of them are educated and well off. They are not sort of illiterate fathers of them. So the question is how do we become legally, socially, health group as part of reproductive health, I think there is an urgency about it.
Mentioned that there are male guys in Rajasthan, and that's true also in the area of Tamil Nadu. Researching, there are male and women, and we want to do it. And it's in the areas also. It's just part of the illustration of the diversity, and then also perhaps the unevenness in this service, the differentiation as well. So, right now, the question before HRLN and whether or not to file a petition, the BIM, in favor of reinstating guys in the NRHM. And I would first of all plead that we haven't had enough education from your side about what are the pros and cons legally and what approaches. I had a chance to read through the 2008 drafting of the draft BIM, and I think parts of it are strong, but parts of it are off the wall and they're not okay. Yesterday in our discussion, we generally felt that I think that we are not ready, without scratching off these issues, we're not ready to file the PIL. On the other hand, we're very much aware of the urgency of it. So, my question that is in my mind topmost is how to move faster on deciding our strategy with regard to rights and then fulfilling the needs and the needs of the support of this. And alongside of this, and one of the needs I think is a strong status report on the situation of work with DAIS, all organizations that have done work with DAIS, and many of them are just out training, but the fact that they've worked with DAIS and together in the same room has been a kind of beginning of organization. So a status report, but who will do this? Can we get an intern to do it? Or two of them maybe to cover the country or cover certain states? Meera Shiva was mentioning that there were
that is not the indicator. Indicator always has the quantitative and the qualitative part. And for the qualitative part, we have to design something according to the hospital or the health facility to find out in the MOC what has actually happened. And if there are gaps, gaps at the structure level, gaps at the supply level, gaps at the inventory level, and gaps at the service level, then certainly we can find out the issue and we can do something from the law. Thank you.
I did this right of home case along with the right of home campaign and the UCL and so on. The contribution is of the UCL and all the other organizations. We will write a small input in terms of law. But we took a situation which in 2001 was so critical, to a situation in 2010 where it is critical but not dying. And now our friends have gone into the National Advisory Committee and so on, and we are hopeful we'll get an act and so on and so forth. So we are not going forward, we are not going backward, but we have invented or got in the system. As far as food is concerned, I believe I think water is such a critical issue where in the next couple of years, if we don't take up as a movement the issue of right to water, we may be completely finished off in that sense. But the right to water movement is a very fragmented movement and it's not able to move. It's a very powerful movement, but very fragmented and not able to come together. The right to food situation, going back again, I'm sorry, I forgot. The right to food situation was very fragmented actually in 2001. And very demoralized, the activists were very demoralized in 2001 when the case was done. We didn't expect to even get admission of the case, but Justice Kirpal had written the petition, made it an all-country petition, and suddenly we got blood in our veins, so to speak, and we were managing to do the case. And then with every order, we got even more Josh, it's a case. One of those strange cases where the legal system gives an impetus to the movement. And today I would say the movement is as powerful as the case, maybe even more powerful than the case. So we are not so dependent on the case anymore, the movement is managing to do its thing much more than that. I believe the right to health is come to that situation, is one of those critical situations because of privatization, where the conditions in the country are so terrible, so awful. Public hospitals are in such terrible shape. You just have to read the Delhi papers to see the leading hospitals, AIIMS, all these Delhi public hospitals, the full page coverage. But the media is doing such a terrific job in exposing the paper of the government hospital. So, privatization has proceeded so much apace. All this rubbish of public-private participation, use of these and all that is so entrenched that if we don't act on the right to health, in the next 1 or 2 years, we will be completely finished. I believe we have no hope. Will the legal system respond? I believe judges are critically affected by what they see and hear around them, particularly the newspapers about the failure of health services. Right across the country, all the newspapers, the journalists, the media are playing a sterling role in outlining what is happening to the ordinary person when he goes or she goes to the public health system. I believe you might get a very, you might get a receptive judiciary that may turn this plot in the system. Every session we were supposed to draw a strategy, now we come to the end of the session. I have a feeling we have cut down some strategy, but to some extent I think we have missed, you know, applying our minds to the political aspects. It's alright, it's part of a process where I remember 2007 when we did our first consultation, there was zero litigation in the country. 2008 it picked up, 2009, 2010 it's really picked up. And I think the seeds of, you know, the possibility or the potential of thinking about the settlement and work and stuff, not through HRLL is very small, very insignificant in the country, very tiny. I don't believe that we can play a small role, but I believe lawyers in the states with whom you are directly in touch with will also, if you train them, play quite an important role. We'll of course do our own mischief, but we are too small to make a critical impact on this country. We have to bring other lawyers and other people and so on. I want to suggest two or three things if you don't mind. First is a judicial colloquium on the right to health. We did a judicial colloquium on the right to education with Anish Sankopal and his entire team. A completely radical presentation on education. We smashed that education bill of double civil. And we did it with such force, 100 judges of the High Court and 2 judges of the Supreme Court supporting. You know, and we talked about globalization, we talked about World Bank, we talked about IMF, we talked about all these things. And the judges really, I felt 80% of the judges really agreed with what was being said. 20% of course got very angry and really short temper tantrum about that. But there was 80% support among the judges for education because they felt poor people and poor children really get a bad. I feel on it on health. If we do a traditional loop, we have a collective effort of about 10 or 12 or 15 organizations. I believe you can do a 2-day or a 3-day, any intensive course for judges. Get them not only to be productive guys, but everything, the whole thing, from public private partners, public hospitals, GDP spending on public health, and all the things on which you have such marvelous material. The health rights movement is really an awesome movement in terms of the people it has, the intellectual, bank that it has, the work that it has done. It's amazing. But I do believe very strongly that not harnessed its potential at all. I think it has harnessed maybe 5% or 3% of its potential. It's a powerful movement that is not born into the legal system. For many reasons, of course. The legal system comes first. The second is to think of public tribunals, people's tribunals and so on issues that we are confronted with where we find that we have to do research for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. Because it's a quick way of getting information across the country, two or 3 days, to get guides and research organizations, health groups coming and giving testimonies before a high panel of retired judges and bureaucrats and so on. And you use that document to work out the strategy and then move forward. Could be. The JSY, for example, and I give you on JSY because, the data that the government has, they're using now, the Lancet article, which came showing that the government won't have to be supporting. They use it in our case in the Delhi High Court, which we do in the first report. They use that saying that they're succeeding, and they gave data showing that institutional mortality is increasing rapidly. And the reason for the fall in mortality, the Lancet article, is because GSY is.